Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to church. If you're watching online, then we welcome you here to Bethany as well. This is Palm Sunday. Now, some of you may know what Palm Sunday's about, some of you may not. I'm not asked for a show of hands to ask what it is, but just in simple terms, Palm Sunday is the Sunday before Easter Sunday. Easter Sunday's next Sunday. And on Palm Sunday, the Lord Jesus rode into Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem, to celebrate the Passover, which was a famous or historical Jewish feast. And he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. So we're going to sing a few songs that are significant about Palm Sunday. The people shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King of Kings." So you might find that a lot of the songs will have the word Hosanna in it. This is the first Sunday that the government has allowed us to meet and not to wear your mask. So if you want to, you can take your mask off. If you feel that you want to keep it on, that's perfectly okay. It's your choice with that. But hopefully we'll be able to hear your voices singing. It's been very strange since last August, when we came back, once we were able to reopen the church, and to hear not the same level of singing in the church. So it would be good to have that volume back again. So we're going to sing this first song that's up on the screen, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." If you're able to stand, then please do so. And if you know it, sing it out. And if you don't know it, hopefully you'll learn the tune by the time we're done. Of peace, you are the Lord of heaven and earth. Now, when I picked this song, Eunice says, "Oh, you're going back in time now." This is a song from the 70s or the 80s, I don't know, but hopefully, if you know it, you'll know the tune, and you'll be able to sing it. "You are the King of Glory, Hosanna to the Son of David."
You are the King of Glory.
let's have a prayer and ask God's blessing this afternoon. Father, we thank you for another Sunday. We thank you that we can have church that we can come to and we can sing praises to your name. We thank you for the message that Adam has prepared to come and give to us today. Bless him, encourage him in what you have taught him in that quiet place. And as he imparts your message today, as your words come through him, Father, we do pray that each and every one of us will be able to gain something from it. So, Father, be with us. Bless us, we pray, in your precious name. Amen. So, Palm Sunday, what does it mean? What is the significance of Palm Sunday? I don't know if you've done any research into it. I don't know if you know anything about Palm Sunday. To my detriment, I would say that I only know little bits and bobs about it. But as I said earlier on, it was the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And this video that we're going to show just gives some of the history behind it, and also the meaning and some of the verses from the Bible that show its significance. So we're going to show it. It lasts about 5 minutes or so. Hopefully you'll gain some historical, if you're into history, some historical knowledge. And if you are into studying the Bible, then hopefully you'll gain some biblical significance with it as well.
Amid shouts of praise and the waving of palm branches, Jesus triumphantly entered into the city of Jerusalem. This event marked the beginning of the most significant week in human history. Understanding the historical setting of this singular event can teach us of the ultimate mission of the Savior as the Lamb of God and the true King of Kings. To better understand the importance of the triumphal entry, it is helpful to first understand its correlation to the feast of Passover or Pesach. Passover was the first of three major Jewish feasts celebrated each year. The feast was to commemorate the deliverance of ancient Israel from bondage in Egypt. According to Exodus 12, the Lord commanded Israel to select a lamb without blemish on the 10th day of the first month. Once selected, the lamb was then brought into their homes to live with the family for the next 4 days. On the eve before the start of the 15th day, they were then to kill the lamb, smear the blood on the doorposts, and share together the Passover feast. If they did this, the Lord promised that the destroying angel would pass by them and spare the firstborn of the home. Every year afterward, Israel celebrated Passover to remember the great deliverance from bondage. In addition, the Jews at the time of Jesus were looking forward to a coming Messiah, who would hopefully likewise, during Passover, deliver them from their Roman oppressors. With this background in mind, let's study the events of the triumphal entry. Shortly before Passover, the Savior began his last mortal journey to Jerusalem. Like Jesus, hundreds of thousands of Jews were also arriving to celebrate the feast. With the city swelling beyond capacity, many would have camped on the Mount of Olives and surrounding areas. Jesus chose to stay in nearby Bethany with the family of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, whom he had just raised from the dead. News of this remarkable miracle spread like wildfire. The promised Messiah had come. As the Savior and his disciples climbed over the Mount of Olives, with the temple glistening in the morning sun, the people cut branches from palm trees, waving them excitedly, and laid their garments on the ground to cover his path. The significance of the timing is unmistakable. According to the Synoptic Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the day Jesus entered was the 10th day of the month, 5 days before Passover. This would mean that on the very same day that the Jews were selecting their Passover lambs, Jesus, the true Lamb of God, rode into Jerusalem and was symbolically chosen by the people. Also, just as the lambs would be brought into the homes of the people to stay for the next 4 days, so too Jesus came into his Father's house, the temple, and taught for the next 4 days before his death. This act of worship by the Jews during the triumphal entry fulfilled the prophecy of Zechariah, which stated, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey." Sadly, as the week progressed, the Jews saw that Jesus did not come as the conquering Messiah they had hoped for. They realized that Jesus would not bring them the political deliverance they so desired. Yet they did not understand the true deliverance he would bring through his atonement, death, and resurrection. Only 5 days later, some of this same crowd who had previously shouted praises at his arrival would now shout for the death of the Lamb of God. Often we are faced with the same question as these Jews in Jerusalem. What type of Messiah are we hoping for? One who will immediately free us from all our challenges and trials? Or are we humble enough to trust in the Lord's timing for redemption? In essence, we all have our own personal Exodus story, a story where we are in spiritual bondage and can be released only by the blood of the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. We each have the opportunity daily to select Jesus Christ as our Lamb of God and allow him into our homes. When we lay down our all before him, as the Jews laid down their garments, shouting Hosanna, we choose to accept the Savior, seeing him for who he really is. Only then can we, like ancient Israel, be spared from the destroying angel of death and sin, and enter into the promised land because of the triumphal entry, death, and resurrection of the Lamb of God.
Few historical items in that video, like the 10th day and things like that. I never knew that until I had watched that video. So hopefully you'll have gained something from it, even if it's to the point that you've found out why Jesus came into the world, then it's of significance to you. I said earlier, we're very pleased to have Adam Ogwu come and speak with us today, and we pray that God will bless you, Adam, as you bring us God's word. Next Sunday is Easter Sunday, as I said, and after the service next Sunday, we're having a lunch, so you're more than welcome to come and stay for that and join with us for some food and some chat, and it'd be great if you could all attend that. That would be brilliant, but if you can't, then understand, but please do come along if you want to. We're going to sing a few more songs, and then we'll hand over to Adam to come and give us the message for this week. Going old school again, give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning till the break of day. Sing Hosanna. So let's hope you can sing this song.
Give me oil in my lamp, give me burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I am ruined. Give me oil in my lamp, give me burning. Give me burning till the break of day. We're gonna sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna.
eyes are turning to you. Song, the boys and girls can go next door and downstairs, and then we'll invite Adam to come and give us today's message. I see the King of Glory. If you want to stand for this one, please do so. You can stretch your backs a little bit.
Coming on the love with fire, the Holy
like the people in that first century as they sung Hosanna in the highest. We're going to ask Adam to come and speak now and give us today's message. Every blessing, Adam, as you come up.
I'll certainly never forget sitting where the children were and seeing the platform, or even seeing this door, and just wondering, A, what was behind it, B, if my legs would stretch far enough for me to make it up the stairs, and three, if I'd ever be as tall as those two boys who walked through last. We don't all have things that we're going to be able to attain in our lives, but as much as I'll never be that tall, I can try and play basketball to level out the advantage that their parents gave them. So, you know, sometimes we don't need to imagine or covet what other people have as an innate attribute. Sometimes we're able to pray to God and boast in the hope that through his plan and following what he's saying to us and the messages he's giving us in our real lives, that one day we might be as good at golf as our Uncle Frank. Good morning, everybody. It is an absolute pleasure to have the opportunity to speak at Bethany again. Looked up words like wonderful Savior strike at the heart of why we're here today. I'll certainly be focusing on our wonderful Savior today, and words like redeemed. Again, very grateful that on Palm Sunday we can think through what that word means and what it means to us. And yeah, I'm in the right place because, as I mentioned, sometimes we pray and we can boast in the hope that we can sometimes get somewhere that we're not right now. However, sometimes to want to get somewhere else, we have to sit and think, where are we now? And sometimes God encourages us to do this, and I think I'll show today, sometimes he encourages us not to think about that question, but to ask it in a different way. Not where am I now, but how has God led me to be here now, and what can I do next? A bit of a more useful question maybe for us to ask ourselves in these times. And a reminder of these times, I'll read a few headlines from a simple Instagram page that I follow. So a few headlines in case you missed them. Home Office said that 12,000 Ukrainians had arrived in the UK so far. 41,000 visas have been granted. Tesco will raise their staff pay in line with their major competitors. Lidl and Aldi, one of my best friends and manager there. Thank you for watching, Miles. Two Extinction Rebellion activists were suspended themselves from Tower Bridge, protesting against fossil fuels. And yeah, a wild turkey in Pennsylvania has baffled scientists by living until it was 12 years old. These animals usually only live until they're 1.5. So where are we? Well, we are here in Bethany Evangelical Church in Paisley. I'm grateful for the presence of each and every one of you, but we're on a planet, we're in a town, we're in a world, we're in the UK. We just facilitated the shipment of weapons to stop what we're deeming to be terrible people doing terrible things to innocent people. I don't think I'm saying deeming there, actually, no. Terrible things are happening to innocent people, and as representatives of this land, we're a part of the efforts to support that. And when we look at today, we look at the sacrifices that are made across the world, we look in our households at the sacrifices that are made through our parents, our brothers, our friends, our uncles who put up with us when we're rambunctious young teenagers, and those that annoy them asking about handicaps in golf when you don't play enough. But life is not just my life, so I realize that other people do other things. We listen to music, we give out gifts, and we take holidays. We sing Christian songs on Easter, we hand out chocolate and give it to each other as gifts, and everybody, whether they're in this building or not, takes some time off. So want to reopen and say this message is for everybody, I think, or I hope, because we're all partakers of these things, whether you're inside this building or not. Yes, hope so. If so, please keep watching. If not, still please keep watching. So, just like Christmas, the words reason for the season go about, and I think that in Easter, again, it's important that the reason for the season is not forgotten. And for me personally, as a Christian, you go through seasons. There are times of lots of prayer, there are times of less. But even in those times of less, I would hope that poise and perspective were there. Reflection and meditation were there. But I'm grateful that those are now somewhat more deeply anchored into the knowing of God rather than the feeling of God, the presence in church, the feeling godly, the doing nice things. No, it's about the knowing of God, and inside that, reflection, meditation, pause, patience, calm are a little easier to attain. And unlike my cousins, I may actually be able to see them in somebody else and pray to God for them and actually get that. I'm not going to be 6'4". If the surgery was available, I wouldn't do it. But I can learn to play basketball just like they can, right? So they have an advantage, but you can practice. You can practice reflection, meditation, poise, calm through every book you want. I'm telling you now, if you reach for something better than the example of the person that you know, you're going to set your targets higher. If you shoot at the stars, you might land on the moon. In times of a world war where all we're looking for is for people to demonstrate these characteristics, I can't think of a better time to start looking past humans. And I can't think of another time where... Okay, no. I can think of loads of other times when the world's been fractured, yes. I can think of one time when God put a person on this earth and the peace and hope and the hope for peace in the hearts of people lasted a lot longer than the next time Vladimir Putin broke his word. I quite like a hope that would last. And for those of us fortunate enough to have family, and for those of us fortunate enough to have supporting families, and for those of us not fortunate enough to have all of the living members of your blood family and who have been able to find friends through Christ or friends through the church, not necessarily by going to Christ, through Christians, through work, through life, have accessed peace and hope. I'm sure this is something that can come from humans. Nobody is denying that. I'll just pop up the verses now, and we're going to have a to Romans chapter 5. So we see here that it says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the everlasting glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Verse 4, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has given to us, who has been given to us. So you see, this hope that we boast in, we don't need to be ashamed of it. We have an everlasting hope, and like a light, we do not need to hide it under a bushel. What would be the point in that? Verse 6 reads, "You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person. Though, for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life?" Amen. How much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life and through his death and through his life? That's the whole point. We have to trust that the death of Jesus and his resurrection, and we have to trust inside them. They're the thing. That's the thing. That's the superhuman that has the attributes of everybody that we would like to look up to. You can only have to start at a starting point of your own personal fallibility. The Bible here is talking about Jesus reconciling us to God because we were sinners. If we consider our sin to be anything that makes us to not be who we desired to be, and if we wake up every morning and go to bed every night and say, every single situation I was in today, I handled as well as I would have done if I'd faced it before, then you don't need Jesus. Okay. If you can go to bed every day and you can say, if I had encountered that situation before, I would not have acted differently, you do not need to be hearing this message. But I think if anybody is honest with themselves, truly honest with themselves, even on a 99.999% of a day, there's always something more. And the goal, the target, the model upon which we reach has to be something that we hope will fill us to the rest of what we're looking for. You could pick out 100 men or 100 women to identify, to help you to have constructed that situation that you're reflecting on doing better on. You could pick 200 people and you still wouldn't have had the right answer. You could have asked all of your friends and all of your family, and it would still have come back into you, and you would have still needed the nuance to understand it yourself, why it was unique to you, how the other actors were in the situation, and how you could act to best optimize the situation. So again, let's think about this. Can we always do what we want to do? Do we execute everything that we set out to execute at the start of the day? And if we do both of those, do we do them as well as we would if we had been able to prepare? I think that we need to become comfortable in our lack of preparedness, because in our lack of preparedness, we embrace it and we look for something that's done it before. Can spend all the time you like asking for your family and friends, and probably if you sit and do meditation and reflection and poise and patience, you'll ask the right ones. But it might be quicker to pray first, because you might just not ask the person who's not going to offer you good advice. I can't think of a time when I'm looking at my leaders and I'm saying, who's advising them? maybe we all need to ask for them to be asking other people, because then they will acknowledge their own limitations and then they might embrace something different from what they're doing. Because I can guarantee you, if Joe Biden and Boris Johnson had the opportunity to review their situation and they knew exactly what was coming, not had a good idea, they knew exactly what was coming, they might do things differently. Unfortunately, I can guarantee you that Vladimir Putin would. Very few of us, though, have the ability to change the world on that scale. And I think that's where we kind of have to come back to, where are we today? Who are we? What are we doing here? And how can the Word of God help us? Well, hopefully, nobody is proclaiming to be a prime minister when they're not. I know I'm certainly not. And I know I'm certainly not claiming to be the physical representation of God here on earth, but I am connected to God through his son. And as I mentioned, at a time when the world is crying out for something other than what we've tried, I remember that on top of all of the skills that I used to use, meditation, mindfulness, poise, and patience, to develop other attributes like calm and confidence, and apparently not the inability to speak with my hands, there was something that pushed me to using those tools better, something that reconciled this gap that I was having between what I'm doing, how things are being perceived in my eyes, how everyone else is perceiving them, and what I can do. I am not able to heal a broken world, and I don't think that the politicians that we have are able to, and I can guarantee you Winston Churchill, if he was around today, would say even the systems that I put in place weren't able to. Man can't prevent war from happening. History repeats itself, right? So when was the last time we can look and we can see and we can trust? This is now we're talking about trust. When is the last time that you, listening to this message, can look on and ask yourself, do I believe that an individual, a force, an entity healed the world? I'd encourage you to look to the story of Easter, if you're ever asking for that question. And if you're ever wondering if that's accessible to you, then I'd encourage you to look at these verses from Romans chapter 5. There are a few verses in the first few verses I just want to quickly go into, address anything that might seem problematic. So if we can just pop them up. The first five verses, please, Lindsay. We saw the word boast, and as we see here, hope, and hope in Jesus, so we can boast in our hope in Jesus. These words are intertwined on our wall here, so to separate them wouldn't be right. But the word boast is something that has to be approached with a lot of caution. We're not told to inflate our own egos. We're taught to boast in the hope of Jesus. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 4 speaks of this. Don't need to change it, please, Lindsay. It speaks of humility being the fear of the Lord. And in James chapter 3, verse 13, we speak about deeds done. We see deeds done in humility, and we're talking about wisdom and understanding. I think that to not go off on another message, just want to clarify that when we're speaking of boasting in the hope of the glory of God, it's not a boasting of self-pride. It is an eternal and very purposeful laying down of our hope, humbly placed at his feet, as we sang in the song, selfless faith. we have selfless faith that he will heal our hearts first. Let's start there. Let's start with letting this word heal our hearts. Then, by God's grace, we'll find family of healed hearts. And hopefully, or more to the point, may we pray that enough of those hearts become presidents and prime ministers in the future. By God's grace, some of them will be women as well. Let's close. Father, Lord, I thank you for bringing us together on this Palm Sunday. We thank you for your birth, which happens at Christmas. And we thank you for your death, which we celebrate at Easter. We thank you that in these walls, the reason for the season is never forgotten. And we pray that in our daily lives, in our hourly actions, and in our minute-by-minute thoughts, that we'll know you, not feel you, not hope that we kind of think that we would understand what we would do, not look at our left hand, left wrist, and look at our bands and say, what would Jesus do, and ask ourselves, but to seek you and know you, so that through us, your sons, who was a model here on earth, can be reflected again. May we be ambassadors of you here on earth through the Holy Spirit. May you heal our hearts. And every time we wonder if this is accessible to us, let us remember that it is. And every time something's telling us to wait a wee bit, let's boast in the hope that our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ is going to bring us through. Heal our hearts, heal our minds, and bless everybody hearing this message and so can get into their hearts and into their minds today. Thank you for these words, and we pray that your will continue to be done everywhere we go. In Jesus' name, amen.